time I have available, I want to just talk a little bit of an extract of some work that's ongoing that tries to look at the proliferation of ski observatories, laboratories, attempts to think about, configure the future of the metropolis through the metaphor and the literal application at times of a certain kind of experimentation. This comes partly out of work we were asked to do for the research councils over a number of months recently, also with other interests in mind. Most straightforwardly, I want to try to kind of just ask for this panel today, ask ourselves what's at stake, what are the politics, what are the ethics, what are the possibilities of this kind of disposition towards the city, how might you think very crudely about what is at stake in the politics of shaping our urban future. And in doing so, there are five points I want to make. Very quickly, there's a point about the horizons of possibility and their uneven distribution. There's a point about thinking about propensity, a point about thinking about emergence. There is a point then about the politics of data, and then a final argument about the ethics of the laboratory. And I'll try and signal each of those rather than go into detail. In the context of the city, we are well aware that futures are unevenly distributed. The horizon of possibility is socially constructed, mediated by all forms of social polarization and injustice. And the technocratic dreams of certain kinds of urban futures that may kind of owe their origins to science fiction may make some manifestations in the claims to their future today, but also actually arise in some more interesting kind of shapes and forms in some of the discussions about how we try and shape a future that is better. In initiatives in the United Kingdom, like the attempt to try and create a program of foresight, that the Future Cities Foresight Initiative that people probably will be aware of in the room, and try to think about how one might actually make sense of urban futures over a timescale of 30 to 40 years. Something that's very different from the everyday life and try and make sense. In terms of the possibilities on short distances and on short timescales. How do we think about that kind of difference? Well, I think in part what we can say is that we might consider the city as a site of possibility. A site of possibility, those of you who remember the work of Salman Rushdie, who argued in cultural terms that the city is the place where newness comes into the world. The city is also the space where we know, through all sorts of theory written by people in this room and also people outside this room, that the city is a space of privileged combination of new forms of materiality, new forms of culture, new forms of economy. That sense of newness is absolutely central to the city. And how we make sense of it, at times, I think we sometimes lose sight of in trying to make understanding that captures a notion of the causal and the deterministic through certain ways of producing city features. There's a book that is part of the signal there that I wrote with colleague Scott Lash and others a couple of years ago, where we tried to make an argument that in China, one of the ways you might make sense of what we describe as a phenomenon of local state capitalism was through understanding the propensity of different urban configurations of material, cultural, political, and economic form to generate different kinds of trajectories, different kinds of path tendencies. It drew partly on the work of François Julien, who's wrote an incredibly beautiful book about the traditions of Chinese philosophy called The Propensity of Things. Julien's book, and if you haven't come across it, makes an argument that someone who spent and he met an argument that within Chinese philosophical tradition, the sense of possibility is much closer to the heart of how people come to think about futures, precisely because in the book he takes the example of theories of war, theories of art, theories of script, and very crudely, I suppose, and simplistically, he makes an argument that the future is always contained in the Aristotle's statue. The marble of the statue is, in Aristotle's term, the material cause of what might emerge. If we're trying to think about cities, what I think it points to is that there's a sense not only of how a notion of emergence might become important, but what emerges is precisely through new combinations of the cultural and the material. If you take Salman Rushdie's notion, you can actually turn that into a different kind of understanding of combination, a kind of different kind of notion of assemblage for those interested in that kind of literature. But most straightforwardly, this begins to help us think a little bit about a lens that takes the city as a system that is open rather than closed, the recent work of John Ardy or in some of the British Senate, more recent work, but also begins to think about what kinds of emergence might produce different sorts of combination of spatial configuration, economic possibility, and how we might think about observing those through particular forms of institutional arrangements. So say there's a multiplication of city labs, observatories, and so on across the world. And I suppose part of the argument that I want to make is that when we begin to think through a language that is part of exposure, as a depth to complex systems theory or nonlinear mathematics, there is a lens which opens up the city in a way that makes a different kind of thinking possible. A different kind of thinking that recognizes the importance of the uniqueness of certain kinds of combination. Is potentially skeptical about the power of data, big data otherwise, but also recognizes the importance of predicting, recognizes the importance of trend, recognizes the futures are not merely extrapolating from trend, but also about thinking about the fashion through which we actually create data about cities that make visible possible futures. What that means, I think very straightforwardly, for those of you who are interested in the more theoretical side of these things, is that we think of cities as being both systems that we can predict in part, and we need to think through the powers of that prediction, but also systems that are subject to path dependency, longer than the language that some people will be familiar with more from science and technology studies sometimes rather than urban studies, but is a language which I suppose recognizes, if you like, the uniqueness of place at the same time the power to think about systems. It's a language which might also recognize in the terms of the cultural historian Mary Booby that when we talk about the politics of data, the subject much in fashion at the moment, we need to think about the ways in which, in her terms, rather than just thinking how we can use the numerical information that exists, we actually need to think about the epistemological instrument produce numerical information that will make what is otherwise invisible appear. Very straightforwardly, this is not an argument against the quantified analysis of data, the systems learning potential of the Internet of Things. It is actually one that instead tries to engage with that world in a way that is productive, is mathematically sophisticated, but also, I try and suggest, by its very nature, rooted in nonlinear mathematics actually begins to create a different sense of mutating possibilities. It means that when we begin to think about futures, it creates a different, I suppose, fourth point, which is the politics of data. It is not that the new urban sciences that we would find just up the road at the Alan Turing Institute or some of the astronomy departments of University College London, for that matter. It's not merely that those forms of data analysis can make plans to scientistic, but it means that we need to think through that lens, but understanding the lens of big data analysis in particular social, political, economic contexts. We need to think about the ways in which claims made in the name of data are also forms of justification. They demand certain kinds of translation between different disciplines, for example, of engineering and mathematics and politics and land use development planning. The kinds of expertise that is at stake in the city. How architects speak to planners through languages, in the case of the architect, that recognize recognizes the Trubian principles of aesthetics of space alongside its utilitarian value and the land use imperatives to create futures in the way Jenny was just talking about now, that have a different kind of logic. How we make commensurable those different logics implies a different sense of possibility, which comes to the final and fifth point I make, which is the ethics of the observatory, which in the work we've tried to do looking at different observatories across the world, there is a sense in which I just want to make just two or three very quick points. One is the extraordinary diversity that is there in the labs and observatories that one finds. That is partly about the ways in which things are structured. People like Simon Marvin are very, very powerful about this, but also it's partly about the ways in which knowledge production relations mimic other kinds of social relations. If you have Michael Bloomberg commissioning New York University to produce material on a contractual basis, then the kind of knowledge that you produce will have all the strengths and weaknesses of the contract that is exemplified by that relationship. If you have in Copenhagen or in Helsinki a relationship where the city sits alongside the observatory, alongside the kind of knowledge production that produces state, private, public interests in different kinds of combinations, then the trust relations in one are not the same as the market relations in the other, or for that matter, in many of the other kind of private-based labs that need inevitably to think about data that is proprietary in forms of intellectual property that are profit-making. And so what that means, I think, in turn, is that if we recognize the importance of what I was trying to say about what is at stake in terms of knowledge production, there's a sense in which, and this comes out a lot, you look at the European Network of Living Labs and other places, this is almost universities, or we begin to think of the city labs and observatories as places where we'll find solutions to the future, we'll be misguided and find chimerical trails that will lead us not very far. But what we might find is that, again, in drawing on Simon Marvin's work and others, that we might think about the experimentation that is possible in these new worlds. And if those experiments create alternative futures, alternative ways of thinking how an architectural logic plays out alongside the land use logic, alongside a value capture logic, then we inevitably create different scenarios that generate different kinds of answers to David Harvey's perennial question, whose image is the city to be remade, right? Because by making visible those alternatives, we inevitably make visible the kinds of trade-offs that are at stake. There is a project that I'm trying to suggest that becomes inevitably ethical at its core. It becomes a generator of different kinds of futures. It becomes less the kind of technocratic imaginary that one sees in those kind of science fiction plays for certain kinds of urban science, but actually engages with data analytics on a serious level to try and make visible alternative futures and make visible the moral choices.